بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله أما بعد. Welcome back to Ummah Radio. And the class that we are doing is on the kitab known as I'la'u Sunan of Mulana Zafar Ahmad Tanvi Rahimahullah. So far we have completed about five classes, having started towards the ending part of September. And tonight inshallah would be actually our sixth class, if you exclude the first one as being simply an introduction. But anyway, in this kitab, it's taken quite some time. As you can see, it's been 1 month so far. And a person may think, what have you really learned? But the thing that I would say at the end of the day is, it's not how much you learn, but rather how much you are able to put into practice. That is what is of the utmost importance. And in this kitab over here, we are learning the basic, you know, the ground rules, the most basic of basic things. In this case, it was the laws of wudu. And the thing is that because everything is backed up with dalil and stuff, a person has no excuse, no reason to doubt it or to say, no, I'm not going to do it. Everything is there in front of you. It's just a matter of putting it into practice. And because the actions and things which are here, there's not a single person, not a single Muslim, but that he has to make wudu, because you've got to perform your salah and whatever other ibadat you want to do, you require wudu. So every single day, you are going to be making wudu. So therefore, this kitab, what we've learned so far, maybe you knew how to perform wudu, but maybe you weren't aware of certain aspects of the wudu. So therefore, you were maybe doing it in this one particular way. Maybe, like for example, we learned the dua, Bismillah walhamdulillah, before starting wudu. Perhaps you weren't aware of it before, but then you did the kitab here and you learned the hadith and you saw that it's from the sunnah to recite it. So you recite it, and that adds extra benefit to and reward to your wudu. So there are many things that it may have seemed small and insignificant to certain people at the time of doing the class, but nothing of the deen is small and nothing of the deen is insignificant. Everything has a reason, everything is there, and everything is there, you will be rewarded for. So with that in mind, we're continuing again with the chapter of wudu, and tonight inshallah we'll be finishing off the topic of rinsing the mouth and the nose, and we'll also be touching on one of the largely forgotten sunnahs. I'm not saying it's forgotten, because there are many people who do it, but I call it largely forgotten because there are many people who aren't even aware that it is from the sunnah, and that is the ruling of making masah of the ears, making masah of the ears to wipe the ears in wudu. But we'll do all of that in due time. So let's begin. Bismillah walhamdulillahi wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillahi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa man wala. So he says, Babu ifradil madmadati min al istinshaq. The chapter with regards to separating the gargling, the rinsing and gargling of the mouth from the rinsing of the nose. They're two separate things with two separate waters, and we touched on this point last week. So let's move on to the hadith, which is the 22nd hadith. عن عبد الله الصنابحي رضي الله عنه أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال إذا توضأ العبد فمضمض خرجت الخطايا من فيه. Famous hadith reported by Hazrat Abdullah الصنابحي رضي الله عنه. He said that رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم said, إذا توضأ العبد, when a person performs wudu, فمضمض, and then he rinses his mouth, he gargles, spits out the water, what happens? خرجت الخطايا من فيه. He sins exit from his mouth with that water. فإذا استنثر خرجت الخطايا من أنفه. When he blows his nose, we're simply talking about rinsing the nose. Don't mistake it and think that, no, you have to throw your head back and gargle and spit out in order for the sins to leave you. And you have to pull water deeply in and blow your nose in order for... That's not what it's being meant. I'm using the words like this here. Gargle. Tamadamada means like to rinse and to gargle. What is important is that you simply clean your mouth. That is what is of the utmost importance. So you rinse and you gargle your mouth. You rinse your nose by pulling water in and blowing it out. This is from the sunnah. And when you do this, kharajat al-khataya min anfihi, then the sins leave your nose as well. Now sins here is of two... There's two ways you can look at this. That when you rinse your mouth, then the sins come out of your mouth. Number one, it can be if you happen to have used your mouth for sinning, then when you make wudu like this, then the sins that you committed with your mouth comes out as well. That's one tafsir, one interpretation of the hadith. And the second is, the sins that you do may not necessarily come from your mouth, but your sins are all encompassing around your entire body. So, hence, when you perform your wudu like this here, any opportunity it has, all those parts of wudu that the water touches, it wipes away the sins when it leaves your body as well. So that is why when you now rinse your nose, then the water, then the sins leave your nose as well. فَإِذَا غَسَلَ وَجْهَهُ خَرَجَتِ الْخَطَايَ مِنْ وَجْهِهِ. When a person washes his face now, then the sins leave his fall off with his face as well. حَتَّى تَخْرُجَ مِنْ تَحْتِ أَشْفَارِ عَيْنَيْهِ. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, so much so that it falls out from underneath his eyelashes. That's how many sins fall off from your face. فَإِذَا غَسَلَ يَدَيْهِ خَرَجَتِ الْخَطَايَ مِنْ يَدَيْهِ حَتَّى تَخْرُجَ مِنْ تَحْتِ أَظْفَارِهِ. When a person washes his arms, then the sins fall off from his arms until so much so that it falls off from underneath his nails. فَإِذَا مَسَحَ بِرَأْسِهِ خَرَجَتِ الْخَطَايَ مِنْ رَأْسِهِ حَتَّى تَخْرُجَ مِنْ أُذُنَيْهِ. When a person wipes his head in wudu, the sins fall off from his head so much so that it comes out of his ears as well. فَإِذَا غَسَلَ رِجْلَيْهِ خَرَجَتِ الْخَطَايَ مِنْ رِجْلَيْهِ حَتَّى تَخْرُجَ مِنْ تَحْتِ أَظْفَارِ رِجْلَيْهِ. When a person washes his feet in wudu, his sins fall off from his feet until it comes out even under his toenails. ثم كان مشيه إلى المسجد وصلاته نافلة. Then he's walking to the masjid after having performed such a wudu, and his salah which he performs in the masjid is extra. Here it don't mean that his salah that he's performing in the masjid becomes a nafil and optional salah. No, here it's using the linguistic sense. Nafila means something which is extra, over and above. So when you walk to the masjid, you have more sins being removed and more reward. And when you perform your salah now in the masjid, you have more extra sins being removed and you have more reward being added to you. So it's like your wudu already removed so many sins, then you walk to the masjid and more sins are removed, you come to the masjid and you perform salah and more sins are removed, and your rank just keeps on going higher and higher. He says, رواه مالك والنسائي وابن ماجه والحاكم وقال صحيح على شرطهما ولا علة له والصنابحي صحابي مشهور كذا في الترغيب. This hadith is reported by Imam Malik, it's reported by Imam An-Nasai, it's reported by Imam Ibn Majah, it's reported by Imam Al-Hakim, and Imam Hakim commented on, saying that it is authentic according to the conditions placed down by both Imam Bukhari and Imam Muslim, Rahimahum Allah. And there's no problem in this hadith here, it's authentic, and Hadhrat Abdullah As-Sunabihi is a famous Sahabi. So here you can see, we did the hadith, we did the references, we have done the authenticity of the hadith, and you've learned something new. Perhaps you weren't aware of how a person may think. There's only four fard actions in wudu, four limbs, which is your face, your arms, wiping your head, and washing your feet. If you do that, your wudu is valid. And maybe you leave out the rinsing of your nose and stuff like this here. But now you can see that things like that, which don't really take much time or effort from you, and even that is an easy means of you having your sins removed. So let's move on to the next hadith. عن طلحة بن مصرف عن أبيه عن جده قال دخلت يعني على النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وهو يتوضأ والماء يسيل من وجهه ولحيته على صدره فرأيته يفصل بين المضمضة والاستنشاق. رواه أبو داود. It reported by Talha ibn Musarrif from his grandfather, who said that I entered upon Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was performing wudu. And he says, وَالْمَاءُ يَسِيلُ مِنْ وَجْهِهِ, that the water was flowing from the face of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and his beard, it was dripping, in other words, عَلَى صَدْرِهِ. So here you see two things. One is that the necessity to wash the face, and you also learn from this that how Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to wash his beard. That we did this in the previous class, the wiping of the beard, the washing of the beard, that you wash it, what is underneath on the face, and you pass your wet hands over it, so that causes the water to flow from your beard. So that is what happening here with Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that the water was dripping from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam's beard onto his chest. And he said, فَرَأَيْتُهُ يَصِلُ بَيْنَ الْمَضْمَضَةِ وَالْإِسْتِنْشَاقِ I saw Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam separating the rinsing of the mouth and the rinsing of the nose, which is what I explained in the last class, is that you take fresh water when you rinse, and you take fresh water when you do your fresh water for rinsing your mouth and fresh water for rinsing your nose. You don't use one handful for both your nose and your mouth. He says, وَسَكَتَ عَنْهُ هُوَ وَالْمُنذِرِ فَهُوَ صَالِحٌ لِلْإِحْتِجَاجِ عِنْدَهُمَا وَحَسَّنَهُ الْحَافِظُ أَبُو عُمَرَ وَابْنُ الصَّلَاحِ كَمَا نَقَلَ الشَّوْكَانِي فِي سَيْلِ الْجَرَارِ كَذَا فِي الْعَرْفِ الشَّذِي وَلَفْتُ الطَّبَرَانِي يَأْخُذُ لِكُلِّ وَاحِدَةٍ مَاءً جَدِيدًا كَمَا سَنَذْكُرُهُ فِي الْحَاشِيَةِ He says that Imam Abu Dawud and Imam Al-Mundhiri, both of them kept silent, hence they consider this hadith authentic in order to derive laws from it. And it's graded as being Hassan also by Hafidh Abu Umar and also by Hafidh Ibn Salah rahimahumallah. And he says this is how it's been mentioned by Imam Ash-Shawkani rahimahullah. And in the narration of Imam At-Tabarani, in his hadith, it said that يَأْخُذُ لِكُلِّ وَاحِدَةٍ مَاءً جَدِيدًا The Sahabi said that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had taken, both for rinsing the mouth and for rinsing the nose, new water each time. In other words, rinse mouth, spit out, get a new handful, rinse your nose, and blow out like that. Okay, I think that's about the only hadith that. Okay, there's two more on the topic over here. Let's move to hadith number 24. عن عثمان رضي الله عنه مرفوعا من توضأ فغسل يديه ثلاثا ثم تمضمض ثلاثا ثم استنشق ثلاثا وغسل وجهه ثلاثا ويديه إلى المرفقين ومسح برأسه ثم غسل رجليه ثم لم يتكلم حتى يقول أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأن محمدا عبده ورسوله غفر له ما بين الوضوءين رواه أبو يعلى He says Hazrat Uthman radiyallahu anhu narrates this hadith marfu'. And what is marfu'? We did this, but I'll touch on it again from the point of mustalahul hadith, because that's how we learn as we go along. If you look at this hadith, Hazrat Uthman radiyallahu anhu, he didn't say Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said this. But marfu'an means he is attributing it to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he said that whoever performs wudu and he washes his hands thrice, and he rinses his mouth thrice, and he rinses his nose thrice, and he washes his face three times, and his arms to the elbows, and he wipes his head, and then after he washes his feet, ثُمَّ لَمْ يَتَكَلَّمْ Thereafter he doesn't speak anything until he says this dua, أَشْهَدُ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ وَحْدَهُ لَا شَرِيكَ لَهُ وَأَنَّ مُحَمَّدًا عَبْدُهُ وَرَسُولُهُ I'll repeat it again. This is what you can also say is one of the du'as after wudu. After you complete your wudu, you say, أَشْهَدُ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ وَحْدَهُ لَا شَرِيكَ لَهُ وَأَنَّ مُحَمَّدًا عَبْدُهُ وَرَسُولُهُ When you say this, what happens? غُفِرَ لَهُ مَا بَيْنَ الْوُضُوءَيْنِ You will be forgiven for whatever sins you had committed between the two wudus. Meaning, let's say for example you make this wudu fajr time, thereafter you come and you're needing to make wudu again dhuhr time, you make that wudu again by dhuhr time, and whatever sins you had committed in that morning, Allah would forgive you. Obviously we know that all of this always refers to minor sins. When it comes to major sins, you've got to make specially tawbah for that. Now he makes mention of here, the hadith is reported by Imam Abu Ya'la rahimahullah, and he says وَهُوَ ضَعِيفٌ كَذَا فِي كَنْزِ الْعُمَالِ وَإِنَّمَا ذَكَرْنَاهُ إِعْتِضَادًا لِمَا قَبْلَهُ He says that this hadith, the chain of narration of this hadith is ضَعِيف. It's what the muhaddithin would refer to as a ضَعِيف hadith. People would say it's a hadith with a weak chain of narration. Now I just want to touch on the topic of using weak narrations or weak chains of narrations over here, because it's a very commonly misunderstood topic. The ruling when it comes to a hadith with a weak chain of narration don't mean that, oh, it's got a weak chain, let's throw it in the bin now, we don't touch on it. Otherwise, if that was the case, the muhaddithin would never have included it in their books. Yet, as you can see, the books of hadith, apart from the Sahihain, Imam Bukhari and Imam Muslim, rahimahumallah, the other muhaddithin, if they felt like Imam At-Tirmidhi, he would find and consider, grade it himself that the narration is weak. Imam Bayhaqi himself graded it that it's weak, and yet include it in his book. Why? The reason for that is because When you hear, you come across a hadith whose chain is weak, what's the first thing you do? No, you don't throw it out the window. The first thing you do is look for a supporting evidence in order to raise its level of authenticity. Therefore, you get to the grading which is known as Hasanun Lughairihi. A hadith which has reached the level of Hasan, and you know we have Sahih, and the very next level underneath it which is authentic is Hasan. So Hasan Lughairihi means that due to the other supporting evidences, this hadith, the chain is raised to the level of authenticity. So that is why you find muhaddithin would report a hadith with ta'if chains. For the reason is, perhaps they only know of this chain here, but later on another muhaddith may come along and he may have a supporting evidence for this hadith over here, which would then raise it from being da'if to being hasanun li ghayrihi, and immediately then it reaches a stage where you can make amal upon it and derive laws and stuff from it. So that is the reason why they put da'if narrations in their kitabs. So this narration over here, he says it is da'if. So number one is, are we learning some, are we derive? Now another point I want to touch on. When the muhaddithin and fuqaha gave the ruling on making amal on a weak hadith, or let me say they use a weak hadith with a weak chain of narration, making amal means you act according to what is mentioned in the hadith. Now what is being meant over here? There are certain times you can use it and there are certain times you can't use it. These weak narrations are fine for use of fadail. You know, when there's a hadith and it speaks about the virtue of a certain thing. So if the hadith speaks of a virtue here that your sins fall off and stuff like this here, there's no problem with that. Because you're not deriving and saying that now you must, let's say for example, the narration comes along, it's got a weak chain, and now it's saying you must make masah on your face and you mustn't wash your face. For example, something of the sort. It's got some new ruling. Or it say when you make wudu, you must also make masah of your chest. For example, it comes along with something which is not known elsewhere. Something new and the chain is not authentic, then in that case then we don't accept it. That's a different story. But yeah, when you have a thing, a narration with a weak chain, but it's referring to fadail, matters of virtues, then in that case it's the salihan, it's permissible and good, or at least I should say it's permissible and fine for use in that situations. And when it comes to the usage of a narration which has a weakness in it like this here, then there's, like I say, the first step that we go to is how can we unite the narrations so that there ceases to be a weakness in it. So the first thing is you look at the support, are there any supporting evidences for this narration. So he says, وَإِنَّمَا ذَكَرْنَهُ اِعْتِضَادًا لِمَا قَبْلَهُ. We use this narration over here as a support for the one that is previously before it. So here, what he's trying to say is that forget about authenticity and all that sort of stuff for here now. All that he was trying to do is show that this one is more explicit in its wording than the previous one, and the previous one was authentic. So that's the reason why I brought it. That's there and good and well and in its place. But the second thing he says here, والحديث وإن كان ضعيفا ولكنه مؤيد بالشواهد القوية منها ما ذكرناه قبل ومنها ما سيأتي. He says that this narration, despite the fact that in and of its own self its chain is considered to be weak, however it is supported through authentic, powerful sources, backup references. So this narration of Imam Abu Ya'la over here, this chain is weak. But this hadith may be reported by Imam al-Nasai, for example. I'm giving a hypothetical situation. May be reported by Imam al-Nasai with an authentic chain. So therefore, what happens? And this is in fact another thing when it comes to grading of the hadith, is that a hadith is not taken in isolation. That, you know, I come across and I'm supposed to be doing a grading of Mishkat, and then I graded the narration as being weak in Mishkat, then I come along and I'm doing a grading of Riyadu Salihin, and I grade the same narration as being authentic in Riyadu Salihin. Then a person say, no, you're not a man who knows hadith, you are a person who's taking chances, you don't know what you're talking about. So the science of hadith, nothing is taken in isolation. When a narration is here and is weak, you put him to the side and then you look at what supporting evidences, are there any supporting ahadith which are strong enough to raise the level of this hadith. So this one here, we say it's weak, by Imam Abu Ya'la. But that's incorrect. The final grading on this narration is that it is hasan. You can make amal upon it. If you're looking at it on its own, it's weak. But the minute you put it into the context of the hadith and what this hadith is giving you, then the other supporting evidences raises its level from being da'if to being hasanun li ghayrihi. So that's just by the way a topic on Mustalah al-Hadith. Keep this in mind. Don't get pulled in and fooled by those people who try and tell you, no, it's a weak narration, throw it out, and all those sort of stuff that they go on like that. The majority of the fuqaha and muhaddithin throughout the ages have always been of the view that you can make use of a weak narration for the purpose of fadail, and when a narration is weak and there are supporting evidences, then the weakness is removed and that narration strength level is lifted up. So in this case here, it's not simply a narration which is left at the level of being weak, rather because of the supporting evidences, it is raised up from that level and taken to the level of authenticity. Alright, let's move on. عن حبان بن واسع الأنصاري أن أباه حدثه أنه سمع عبد الله بن زيد بن عاصم المازني يذكر أنه رأى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يتوضأ فتمضمض ثم استنثر ثم غسل وجهه ثلاثا. الحديث رواه سعيد بن منصور ومسلم وأبو داود والترمذي. إمام حبان بن واسع الأنصاري narrated from his father who heard عبد الله بن زيد بن عاصم المازني رضي الله عنه saying that he saw Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam performing wudu. And what happened? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam rinsed his mouth, thereafter he rinsed his nose, thereafter he washed his face three times. So again, each of these ahadith are here to show the rinsing of the mouth and the rinsing of the nose are two separate things. You may say, but it's something seemingly small. But like I said in the beginning, nothing is small. Everything of the deen is important. Everything has its place. So nothing is insignificant. So this is the hadith reported by Imam Sa'id ibn Mansur, and it's also reported by Imam Muslim as well as Imam Abu Dawud and Imam At-Tirmidhi rahimahumullah. Okay, so here we have the end of this chapter with regard to the rinsing of the mouth and the nose. I'm not going to go into the further details, you know, from all the various opinions that the various ulama held and all the stuff like that, because like I mentioned last week, it's not something that people argue about. Everybody know you rinse your mouth, you rinse your nose, it's two separate times you take water, no question about it. It's simple, it's straightforward, so there's no need to spend an excessive amount of time on it. So let's move on to the next chapter. It says باب مسح الأذنين بماء الرأس وصفة مسحهما. The chapter with regards to masah of the ears, wiping the ears in wudu, and he says بماء الرأس, using the same water that you wiped your head with. In other words, you made masah of your head and then of your ears as well. Bima'i ra'as. This is what you call using one set of water, not wiping your head, then wetting your hands, and then wiping your ears. It's being done all in one fluid motion. And wasifatu mashihima, how will you wipe your ears? That's what this chapter will deal with. So now let's do the hadith. عن ابن عباس رضي الله عنهما أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم توضأ فغرف غرفة فغسل وجهه ثم غرف غرفة فغسل يده اليمنى. Again, you know, look how many ahadith. If you think we are now currently on our 26th hadith from this chapter over here, and all of these ahadith has been on the method of performing wudu. So many different sahaba, Hadrat Ali, Hadrat Abdullah ibn Abbas, Hadrat Abdullah Sunabihi, Hadrat Uthman, Hadrat Anas, how many other sahaba, all reporting different ahadith, slight changes, a little bit more information here and there, all just on the topic of wudu. We've gone so long for a month and we've only spent it on the first beginning aspects of wudu. We've not even gotten into the main part of wudu itself yet. So anyway, Hadrat Abdullah ibn Abbas radiyallahu anhu, he said that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam performed wudu and took a handful of water and washed his face. Thereafter took another handful of water and washed his right arm. ثم غرف غرفة فغسل يده اليسرى. Thereafter he took a handful of water and washed his left arm. So in this hadith over here, what it's showing is washing one. You know, like I mentioned in the beginning, the last week, that when you've got three choices, you wash your limb once, valid, you wash it twice, better, and you wash it 3 times, and that will be the best, and that's also the maximum. So yeah, in this case, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam washed 1 time to show for us the bayanul jawaz, the permissibility, that if you wash it once, it is valid, as long obviously as you have washed the limb completely. ثم غرف غرفة فمسح برأسه وأذنيه وأخلهما بالسبابتين وخالف بإبهاميه إلى ظاهر أذنيه. Here he comes to the point. He says that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam took a handful of water and wiped over his head and his ears. وأخلهما بالسبابتين, and made خلال of his ears using his سبابتين. سبابة is the Arabic word for the index finger. Sababatain, the two index fingers. So akhallahuma means that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam used his two index fingers to place in his ears to clean the inside of his ears. Wa khalafa bi ibhamayhi ila zahiri udhunayhi, and Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam used his thumbs to clean the outside of his ears. So understand and try and visualize and picture this over here. You've wiped your head, you brought your hands down from the, so to say, the top back part of your head, you put your two index fingers into your ears. Obviously both your finger, your hands will still be wet by this time, so you place it in your ears and you, so to say, you roll it around inside your ears, touching all the parts that you can touch, the whole inner shape of your ear. You wipe with your index fingers, and obviously your thumb naturally now is behind your ear, so you wipe from the bottom of your lobe up to the top of your ear. You know, like, and you come back down, whatever, however way you do it, but you make certain that you wipe both the inside and the outside of your ear, including the lobe, everything, in one fluid motion, like that. Further ahadith will come and speak more on this topic, but for now, just keep that in mind, that after wiping your head, you take your hand straight down and you make masah of your ears. So here again, it's something which Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam had done, and therefore it forms part of the Sunan of Wudu. Something seemingly small, and yet there is a reward in it. Okay. ثم غرف غرفة فغسل رجله اليمنى ثم غرف غرفة فغسل رجله اليسرى. Thereafter, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam took a handful of water and washed his right foot, and then afterwards another handful of water and washed his left foot. رواه ابن حبان في صحيحه وابن خزيمة وابن مندة. التلخيص الحبير. Imam Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani rahimahullah, he mentions in At-Talkhis al-Habir that this hadith is reported by Imam Ibn Hibban in his Sahih, and reported by Imam Ibn Khuzayma in his Sahih, as well as being reported by Imam Ibn Mandah rahimahullah and various other muhaddithin as well, Imam Ibn Majah, Imam al-Nasa'i, Imam al-Hakim, Imam Bayhaqi and others. So, you know, authentic hadith. Let's do the next hadith. عن ابن عباس رضي الله عنهما أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال الأذنان من الرأس. رواه الدارقطني وفي تخريج الزيلعي قال ابن قطان إسناده صحيح لاتصاله وثقة رواته. Hazrat Abdullah ibn Abbas radiyallahu anhuma, he narrates that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, the ear al-udhunani min al-ra'as, the ears are part of the head, the ears belong to the head. Now the Fuqaha have commented on this hadith. What is being meant by this? Does this mean that that your ears are part of your head and it's not part of your arm? No. Because you know that that's common sense. Everybody know your ears are on your head. So what is being meant here is that your ears are washed, or at least wiped, part of your head in wudu. That is the reasoning and the meaning that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was trying to imply by saying al-udhunani min al-ra's, that the ears are part of the head. In other words, not al-udhunani min al-wajh, that the ears are part of the face, because that would mean when you wash your face in wudu, you have to wash your ears. But rather, al-udhunani min al-ra's, that the ears belong to the head. Hence, when you wipe your head in wudu, then you will wipe your ears as well. Hadith is reported by Imam Ad-Darqutni rahimahullah, and in the takhrij, of Imam Az-Zaylai rahimahullah, Hanafi faqih muhaddith, he makes mention of it, and he says that Imam Ibn Sa'id al-Qattan, Ibn al-Qattan at least, he said that the sanad of this hadith is sahih because it is muttasil, there's nobody missing from the chain, and all the narrators are authentic. So in other words, this hadith is authentic. So here we have our first Okay, let me just read the next hadith that's the same thing. عن عبد الله بن زيد قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم الأذنان من الرأس رواه ابن ماجه ورجاله رجال مسلم إلا حبيب بن زيد وذكره ابن حبان في الثقات في أتباع التابعين كما في تخريج الزيلعي وفي التلخيص قواه المنذري وابن الدقيق العيد. So here we have a second hadith on the same topic reported by more muhaddithin, Imam Muslim. So already when people hear it reported by Imam Muslim in his Sahih, any doubts they may have is out the window. Imam Ibn Majah reported, so many of the muhaddithin have reported this hadith and it's all authentic. So, Imam Ibn Majah reported, and the narrators in this hadith over here is the narrators which are all found and accepted by Imam Muslim. Not that it's reported by Imam Muslim, except for one narrator. The narrator by the name of Habib ibn Zayd, and this man, Habib ibn Zayd, he is from the Atba'u Tabi'een, meaning the generation which came just after the Tabi'een. Imam Abu Hanifa and Imam Hassan al-Basri, Ata ibn Abi Rabah, all of them were from the Tabi'een. Imam Malik and Imam Shafi'i and many of the others, they were from the Atba'u Tabi'een. They were those who saw the Tabi'een and did not see the Sahaba radiyallahu anhum. So Habib ibn Zayd, he was one of those Atba'u Tabi'een. And Imam ibn Hibban has graded him as authentic and put him in his kitab al-Thiqat. So this kitab of Imam ibn Hibban al-Thiqat, everyone in whose name is mentioned in that kitab is considered to be authentic in the eyes of Imam ibn Hibban rahimahullah. وفي التلخيص, he says Imam Ibn Hajar mentions in At-Talkhis al-Habir that Imam al-Mundhiri and Imam Ibn Daqiq al-Aid, both of these muhaddithin, have also graded this narration as being authentic. So you know, you've got already a number of muhaddithin grading the narration to be authentic and reliable, and we know now what the law is that we are deriving from this particular hadith. I'm not going to go into, there's a lot of fiqhi details and a difference of opinions and stuff like this here. I'm not going to get into all of that debates and stuff, because we understand it. There's nobody who considers their ears to be part of their face. Everybody, without exception, wipes their ears as part of their head. So therefore, what we are wanting to do here is establish the sunnah action of wiping the ears. That's all that we are wanting to do. Not debate whether your ears belong on the top of your head, on your back, or on your face. We just wanting to know, you wipe it when you wipe your head, and that's where we stop. So that's established. So now we can move on with our next hadith, our 29th hadith. عن ابن عباس رضي الله عنهما أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم مسح أذنيه داخلهما بالسبابتين وخالف إبهاميه إلى ظاهر أذنيه فمسح ظاهرهما وباطنهما رواه ابن ماجه وفي تخريج الزيلعي قال في الإمام وهذا إسناد صحيح. Same hadith as previously reported by Hadhrat Abdullah ibn Abbas رضي الله عنهما. He said that Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم wiped his ears in wudu, the inside using his index fingers and the outside using his thumb, and so therefore he wiped the inside and he wiped the outside as well. It's reported by Imam Ibn Majah, and Imam Az-Zaylai, he mentions that this the chain of narration of this hadith is sahih. It's an authentic hadith. Let's do one more hadith so we can have at least 30 hadith done from this kitab. So حدثنا محمود بن خالد وهشام بن خالد المعنى قال حدثنا الوليد بهذا الإسناد المذكور من قبل هذا قال ومسح رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم بأذنيه ظاهرهما وباطنهما زاد هشام وأدخل أصابعه في صماخ أذنيه. Okay, so here we have let me just read the finish. رواه أبو داود وسكت عنه وفي التلخيص الحبير أبو داود والطحاوي من حديث المقدام ابن معدي كرب ورضي الله عنه وإسناده حسن. So here we have one more hadith, our 30th hadith, and in this hadith it's reported by Mahmud ibn Khalid and Hisham ibn Khalid al-Ma'na. Now here we have another point, which is that this narration is narrated by two different people. This This hadith is reported, as he said, yeah, by Abu Dawud. Imam Abu Dawud, rahimahullah, had gotten this hadith by a man by the name of Mahmud ibn Khalid, as well as gotten the same hadith from a man by the name of Hisham ibn Khalid. And then he mentioned al-ma'na, the meaning. What is the meaning? Or at least, what does he mean by this point of saying al-ma'na? This is a term which is used in the books of the muhaddithin. When they say al-ma'na, they mean al-ma'na wahid, that the meaning of both the hadith of these people is the same. So in other words, both of these people narrate this hadith, and the meaning of both the narrations is the same. So therefore, I'm going to use the quote, in other words, I'm quoting one wording because both of them report with the same wording. Okay, so anyway, he qala, dual form. Both of them said, حدثنا الوليد بهذا الإسناد, that both of us were narrated to by الوليد with this chain of narration. He says, المذكور من قبل هذا, we already passed by the chain of narration before this. So anyway, he says, ومسح رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, and رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم wiped بأذنيه ظاهرهما وباطنهما, wiped the inside and the outside of his ears, زاد هشام وأدخل أصابعه في صماخ أذنيه, and رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم inserted his fingers into the passageway of his ears. Obviously, you don't mean shove your finger deep down into your ear till you reach your brain. That, again, we're not going to extremes over here. We're talking, you clean the inside, the open part, and then you just go just a little bit into the, you know, as far as your finger can go. Don't try and push it deep into your ear like that. It's just that you wipe to the best of your ability. That is what is required. That's all that's asked from you. You're not asked to go and push things into your head. So here, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when wiping the inside of his ears, he had put his fingers deep enough in to reach the passageway of the ear. And that's as far as Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam had gone. Okay, so anyway, we know Imam Abu Dawud reported it and kept silent, and we know from now, enough times we mentioned it, that when he keeps silent on a hadith, it means he considers it to be authentic. But anyway, if you differed with that, Imam Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani rahimahullah reports in At-Talkhis al-Habir, and he said that Imam Abu Dawud and Imam al-Tahawi both report this hadith from Hadrat Miqdam Ibn Ma'adi Karib, and they say, both of them said that the chain of narration is hasan, it is authentic, it's reliable. So even if you were to say, no, I can't, did Imam Abu Dawud really mean it's authentic? Even if you doubted that, here we have the words of Imam Ibn Hajar, and he, as he says, the chain of narration is authentic. Okay, I think we'll do one final hadith, hadith number 31, and then we can stop on to that point for tonight, inshallah. So he says, حدثنا إبراهيم بن سعين قال حدثنا وكيع قال حدثنا الحسن بن صالح عن عبد الله بن محمد بن عقيل عن الربيع بنت معوذ أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم توضأ فأدخل إصبعيه في جحري أذنيه رواه أبو داود وسكت عنه. I'll read the hadith in portions. So, you know, this is now a standard style of a hadith. حدثنا إبراهيم بن سعيد قال حدثنا وكيع. All narrating it, the way a chain of narration actually moves, that so-and-so narrated to me, or narrated to him from so-and-so, like that, using the term حدثنا. So I'm going to do it in the proper terminology, is حدثنا إبراهيم بن سعيد, that Ibrahim ibn Sa'id narrated to us, and he said حدثنا وكيع, that وكيع would be وكيع ibn al-Jarrah, the teacher of Imam al-Shafi'i rahimahullah, he narrated to us, and he said حدثنا الحسن بن صالح, that Hassan ibn Salih narrated to us عن عبد الله بن محمد بن عقيل, from Abdullah ibn Muhammad ibn Aqil, from الربيع بنت معوذ, from الربيع, who was the daughter of معوذ. And who is this? This is الربيع بنت معوذ ibn عفراء, one of the two sons of عفراء. معاذ and معوذ ibn عفراء, this was Mu'awad ibn Afra's daughter. So she said, that Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam performed wudu, and he placed his two fingers into the entrances of his ears. In other words, the same as the previous hadith, just using a different wording, that he placed it into the openings of his ears. And I explained this just a moment ago, so I'm not going to repeat it again. You don't push it in to kill yourself, you just put it in as far as you can go, and that's all. So Imam Abu Dawud reports this hadith wasakata anhu, and he does not comment on it. قلت وقد روى الترمذي حديثنا عن عبد الله هذا عن الربيع ثم قال حسن صحيح. And he mentions here that Imam al-Tirmidhi rahimahullah has reported the same hadith from Abdullah, the same Abdullah from al-Rabi' binti Mu'awith ibn Afra. And thereafter Imam al-Tirmidhi, grading the hadith himself, he says that it is Hasanun Sahih. Now, before we go any further, the terminology of Imam al-Tirmidhi is different from any of the other muhaddithin. You know, we've passed by many times now. Muhaddithin would say, "Hadha hadithun sahih," "Hadha hadithun hasanun," "Hadha hadithun da'if," so on and so forth. Using one single term, the narration is sahih, the narration is hasan, the narration is da'if, and so on and so forth. But Imam al-Tirmidhi, he was slightly different. He would use two terms at least, sometimes three, you know, "Hadha hasanun sahihun gharib," "Hasanun sahihun gharib," for example, he would use it in that manner. So here he says, like his standard thing is "Hasanun sahih." Now, because Imam al-Tirmidhi is the only muhaddith who used this style, therefore, and he also did not expound upon it himself, so the muhaddithin and fuqaha are actually unaware of what exactly did Imam al-Tirmidhi mean by this. But anyway, what the fuqaha and muhaddithin have mentioned is that when Imam al-Tirmidhi graded the narrations like this, his reasoning behind it was this, that it is hasanun li nafsihi sahihun li ghayrihi, that intrinsically this narration itself is on the level of hasan, but due to its supporting evidences it gets raised to the level of sahih, so therefore it is hasan and sahih at the same time. So you can keep that as a general rule in mind for the gradings of Imam al-Tirmidhi rahimahullah. When he used two terminologies like that, that's normally what he is meaning. وقال في أوائل كتابه عبد الله بن محمد بن عقيل هو صديق وقد تكلم فيه بعض أهل العلم من قبل حفظه وسمعت محمد بن إسماعيل يقول كان أحمد بن حنبل وإسحاق بن إبراهيم والحميدي يحتجون بحديث عبد الله بن محمد بن عقيل. Now, yeah, this is all the words of Imam al-Tirmidhi. So he mentioned here, وَقَالَ فِي أَوَائِلِ كِتَابِهِ, that Imam al-Tirmidhi mentions in his kitab that Abdullah ibn Muhammad ibn Aqil huwa saduq. Now this is from the words of Jarh wa Ta'dil. When a person is being graded as being saduq, it means he is reliable, you can take from him, he is not a liar. Saduq means he's truthful, so his narrations are authentic. In other words, when a person is graded as saduq, he's basically being put under the i'tidal. You know, the science is known as al-jarhu wa ta'dil. Literally, al-jarhu means that you find fault with someone, censure them, you reprimand them, that type of meaning you get from jarh. And ta'dil is like the person is upright and reliable and stuff like that. So it's narrator criticism, either he's reliable or unreliable. So when they use a term like saduq, they use all these terms specifically. It all have a specific meaning. It's not just, I translated in English as authentic, because at the end of the day, when we are deriving the laws, that's where the buck stops. But as far as the muhaddithin were concerned, everything had a reason behind it. So this man, Abdullah ibn Muhammad ibn Aqil, he says that he is saduq. Imam al-Tirmidhi says that he is saduq. When he says that the man is saduq, it means that he is truthful and you can take from him. But there's a but surrounding him. So what is that but? So he says, وَقَدْ تَكَلَّمَ فِيهِ بَعْضُ أَهْلِ الْعِلْمِ مِنْ قِبَلِ حِفْظِهِ. But some of the ulama have spoken about him with regards to his memory. Because Muhammad ibn Abdullah ibn Muhammad ibn Aqil, he had a little bit of a weak memory. So in hadith, having a bit of a weak memory, it's like muhaddithin don't want to just accept from you. So therefore he say some of the muhaddithin have spoken about him, it's like that he don't have too good of a memory. But I asked Muhammad ibn Ismail about it. And you know, this is Imam At-Tirmidhi's most famous teacher, the one that he is closest to, the one that he referenced and quote most often in his kitab. And who is Muhammad ibn Ismail? Muhammad ibn Ismail is Muhammad ibn Ismail ibn Ibrahim ibn al-Mughirah ibn Bardizm al-Ju'fi al-Bukhari, Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah. That is who Muhammad ibn Ismail is. So whenever you see Imam At-Tirmidhi saying, I asked Muhammad ibn Ismail about this, he's referring to Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah. Anyway, so I asked Imam al-Bukhari about this and he said that Kana Ahmad ibn Hanbal, that Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal and Imam Ishaq ibn Ibrahim and Imam al-Humaydi, all three of these famous ulama, they يحتجون بحديث عبد الله ibn Muhammad ibn Aqil. All three of them, they used to accept and use the narrations of Abdullah ibn Muhammad ibn Aqil and derive laws with it and everything. So all three of them regarded him as being authentic. قال محمد محمد again محمد بن إسماعيل meaning Imam al-Bukhari, he says وهو مقارب الحديث قلت كفى به قدوة لا سيما إذا وافقه فيه غيره أيضا وبقية رجال السند رجال مسلم. Now yo, one more point of مصطلح الحديث we learn here. He says that he is Imam Bukhari in grading Abdullah ibn Muhammad ibn Aqil, he says that he is Muqaribul Hadith. Now what is Muqaribul Hadith? Muqaribul Hadith is the terminologies that the Muhaddithin, again, when they want to say a person is acceptable, they would say he is, for example, he is thiqa, he is saduq, one of the and other type of terms like this, and one of those terms is Muqaribul Hadith. So it is from the min al-fadhi ta'dil. Now, why make a difference between sahih? Why make a difference between, why the need for all of these different terms? Imam al-Sakhawi, rahimahullah, who is the student of Imam Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani, he explains this. He says, وَسَطٌ لَا يُنْتَهَى إِلَى دَرَجَةِ السُّقُوتِ وَلَا الْجَلَّالَةِ وَهُوَ النَّوْعُ مَدْحٍ. That this term, مقارب الحديث, it is a moderate type term. They are not saying that his narrations are so weak that we're going to reject him. No, are we putting him there on the level of صحة, that you know he is on par with the main narrators of hadith, the famous with ones that are graded as being sahih. We're not going to put him there, nor are we going to reject his narration. So he is in the wasat, he is there in the middle. We accept from him, he's acceptable and reliable. He had a little bit of a weak memory, but the weakness of his memory in that case did not affect his hadith, so therefore we still accept his hadith. But knowing that there exists some difference of opinion with regards to him, even though the majority all accept him, so we accept him, but you know, when we are grading and we're talking about who is more reliable, who is more authentic, then all of that, they've got gradings and ratings. Are you a level 1 or a 2 or 3, stuff like that. So if you are level 10 sahih versus for example a level 5 muqarib al hadith, if I were to put it in those terms. So he says, this is Mulana Zafar now, he says that قلت كفى به قدوة, that Imam, this is sufficient of an example and to follow of Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah. And why not إذا وافقه فيه غيره أيضا. Why would a person want to differ when others apart from Imam Bukhari have also agreed with it? Like we mentioned a moment ago, Imam Ahmad, Imam Ishaq ibn Ibrahim, Imam al-Humaydi and others too, all considered this narration to be authentic. So we've got Imam Tirmidhi, Imam Abu Dawud, Imam Bukhari, Imam Ahmad, Imam Ishaq ibn Ibrahim, Imam al-Humaydi and others, all grading this narration as being authentic. So why do you want to say no, it's not authentic? Sufficient have graded it as being authentic. It says, "La sayyima." Okay, wabqiyatu rijalu sanad, and the rest of the narrators of the chain are rijalu Muslim, are the same narrators found in Sahih Muslim. Hence, we can conclude that the chain of narrators, all of them are authentic, reliable, trustworthy people. So, therefore, this hadith is authentic. The next hadith is quite a lengthy one, but seeing as we are on that topic over there, it's all dealing still with the same topic of wiping on the ears. But we will stop on this point here, inshallah. Until next time, next week we can continue and complete this chapter and enter into a new chapter again. But that will be next week, inshallah. hopefully same time. Oh, and by the way, the radio times may be changing after the UK have the clocks changed from BST to GMT, from British summer time to, you know, the regular, from plus one to being plus two again. So the radio class times may change. You can keep up to date on the forum for the official posting times. When it's confirmed, will be posted there, inshallah. But that is, that's until next time. For now, we end. Wa sallallahu wa sallama wa baraka ala nabiyyina Muhammad. Subhanallahi wa bihamdihi. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdik. Nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta. Nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk. Wassalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.